Happy Sabbath to you. Happy Sabbath. Happy Sabbath to those who are watching us through the internet. This is your Sabbath school, a place to learn, a place to grow, and a place to share. To learn about Jesus, to grow in fellowship with each other, God, and to share the many blessings that we have received from Him. As we begin, let's have a word of prayer. Gracious Father, we thank you for the beautiful Sabbath day that you have given to us. As we begin the Sabbath school, ready to open the scriptures, we invite the Spirit to guide us and help us in understanding it and in sharing it. In Christ's name we pray, amen. See, I see the Sabbath school as a place to learn, to grow, and to share. Now remember those three words, because at the end, this is the Sabbath school, at the end I'm going to ask you for those three words. You remember them? The Sabbath school is the place where we come to learn, to grow, and to share. Let's go over them. Learn.
Grow,
share. Now, I'm going to talk about sharing. Because this is a very important aspect of the Sabbath school. I don't have much time, so I'm going to tell you two, perhaps three things about sharing. The first one is coming in the test, so get ready, memorize it. The first one, we all have something to share. Am I right? Yeah. I mean, as long as you are alive, you have something to share. Your life. You can share without costing you anything, a smile, a word, a greeting. We share. This is the nature of life. We share with each other. And we have something wonderful to share, Jesus Christ. Am I right? Yes. But in order to share Jesus, you have to know about him. You have to know that he's the Son of God, the Savior, our guiding light. He's the one that is coming soon. So you need factual information. You have to know something in order to share Jesus. The second thing that I'm going to say is, in order to share in an effective way, you have to put into practice what you know. See, there is a little distance between the brain and the hands. Am I right? There is a little distance, less distance, but there is some, between the brain and the mouth. And there is quite a bit of distance between the brain and the feet. What do I mean by all this? You put into practice what you know, using your body. You can keep things in your mind without moving. Most of you are not moving. And you're thinking, you have things in there. But if you want to share, you have to take that which is inside and exteriorize it through the word. How are you doing today? You know, I was praying for you last evening. Is there a way I can help you? This is the mouth. Do you know about Jesus? I love Jesus. Shake hands, the touch, it's extremely important, touchy. And I'm going to the hospital to visit a church member who is sick, and I use my feet. You have to put into practice in what you believe in order for sharing to be effective. Let me tell you a quick story. It's about me, okay? Don't blame me. It happened to me. I was a senior in high school. And somehow the high school, it was a large high school, knew that I was a religious young man who had the ability to talk in public. You know, in church, you grow up talking in public, so you learn about how to speak to a crowd. And they had some activities in the school. I was the person in charge of the program. And one week, the principal called me to his office. A very wise old man, very wise. I was a young fellow. What, 14, perhaps 15? And he said, Angel, sit down, please. So I sit down. I said, listen, I need your help. I need your help. We're going to have a social program with singing and music, and we need somebody to be there in charge. And I would like you to do it. And I said to him, well, if I can be of help, it's going to be this Friday evening. Did you hear? He said, it's this coming Friday. This is the moment when what you think and what you say has to coincide. I looked at him and I said, no, I cannot do it Friday evening. Oh, why? Well, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. So I explained to him, you know. And he said, okay. He took a piece of paper, a pencil, and said, give me the name of your pastor at the telephone. I will call him and ask him to excuse you. Sharing. I told him it's not a matter between the pastor and me. It's between Jesus who gave me this. See, you have to, what is in the brain has to be activated in order to share it. The third thing that I want to say about sharing is you have to feel good about what you're going to share. If you have apples and there is a rotten apple, you're not going to feel good giving the rotten apple to friend. You look for the best one, right? The one you feel good about. You have to feel good. I love Jesus. I share him because I'm enthusiastic about him. You know, I tell people, God bless you. Anywhere I go, I find somebody who gave me the chance and I bless them. I feel good because Jesus blessed me, so why not? You feel good about it. We had meetings some years ago. We have some meetings in Europe with a number of non-Adventist theologians, 8 non-Adventist theologians, 8 Adventist theologians in dialogue, in conversation. We did it for 4 years, a week every year, a week. You took with you the Bible, period. No dictionaries, no commentaries, just the Bible. And the third year, during the third year, the theologians from the other side, all of them walked into the meeting room with an Adventist book. The book about our fundamental beliefs. If you don't have the book, get it and read it. And we wonder what is going on here. They sat, and at one moment during the morning, their leader stood up and said to us, you saw us coming in with this book. I'm going to tell you why. We agreed among ourselves to buy the book and read it. And I tell you, he said to us, I tell you this, there is so much in this book in common with us that we felt very good. Now I have a question for you, he said. What is in this book, you know, the fundamental beliefs, what is in this book is something that Adventists believe around the world? And we smile. He said, yes. And then he asked again, he asked, listen, are you sure that this book is everywhere in the Adventist world and that everybody believes what is in there? Well, this time we were a little more careful. We said, there may be some places where some people may differ a little bit from what is in the book, but it is basically what we teach and believe. And he stood tall and he said to us, I wish my church would have a book like this. Did you hear that? I don't want to mention the denomination, that's why I cannot explain to you why he said that, but he was right. They would never be able to have a book like the one we have. You feel good, you see? You see that what you have is valuable, that you can share it with others, that we don't have to feel, you know, a little ashamed talking about Jesus and talking about our doctrine. Don't be. It's valuable. People outside the church, theologians outside the church told us, this is unbelievable. We have one body. Now, the last thing I'm going to tell you is, it is, listen carefully, it is impossible not to share. Did you hear that? Even if you say, I'm not going to share. If you know what you believe and you put it in practice, it is impossible not to share what you believe. I'll tell you a story, short one. They had to be so short. We were in Africa, and we had a Bible conference there. We had theologians from Africa and pastors. It was a big meeting. And we brought with us some Adventist scientists to join us to talk about evolution and science and faith. And at the end of the meeting, the two scientists said to me, Angel, we're going to go to the mountains because there are some type of stones or something there that they wanted to study. You see, they read the stones. I read the Bible. I don't know how to read the stones, but they are scientists, geologists. Said, would you like to come with us? And I said to them, well, if you teach me a little bit of how to read the stones, I'll be happy to. So next day, there is a taxi waiting for us. The taxi is going to be with us the whole day. The driver is an African young fellow, tall, strong, Muslim. He's very kind, you know, he's selling his services, so he comes and shakes hands, and very, very nice. In fact, I found the Muslims in many parts of the world to be very friendly. So we got in the car, And I had no choice, I had to take the passenger seat. And I'm thinking, what, you know, how do I engage the driver in a conversation? I don't want to offend the driver. But you see, in my case, I'm always thinking about what can I do to say something to somebody. So I'm sitting there saying, how do I initiate this conversation? So I said to him, are you a religious person? He could say no, and that's the end. Or he could say yes, and he said yes. Yes, I'm a Muslim, very happy, very proud to tell me that he's a Muslim. I'm a Muslim, you know. And I said to him, oh, I have some Muslim friends, and they're wonderful people. And then he turns to me and says, and you, are you a religious? And I say, yes. The three of us were Christians, Seventh-day Adventists. Say, you are Seventh-day Adventists? Say, yes. In my village, there are many, many of you. Let me tell you, they are better Muslims than we are. They go to the mosque, the church, several times a week. They spend the whole day, one day, they spend it going out and singing and helping people. And he went on and on and on. Now, these church members didn't know that they were sharing their faith with this young man by simply living out their faith. When you know what you believe and you put it in practice, it's impossible not to share. And we had a wonderful conversation with this young man. He was more enthusiastic about Adventism than we were, because he saw something wonderful among the community of Adventist believers in his small village somewhere in Africa. Isn't that wonderful? So, I'm here to tell you this. This week, which is coming after sunset, share. Share. A piece of bread, an apple, an orange, a book, a word about Jesus. Just do it. It's a wonderful experience. You come out of it rejoicing, because there is a blessing for you when you share. Let's pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for the call that you have given to all of us to share you, the message that you gave us, the hope that you have implanted in our hearts. I pray for this, your people. Bless them this week, coming week. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we do have several classes. There is one on my right behind the glass window, and there is another one on my left. I think this is for young adults. There is one here in the sanctuary, and there is one in the library, and upstairs, in the room upstairs, is another one. Feel free to attend any one of them. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
traveling or moving or something during that time when they were recording Advent Hope Sabbath School. So I think he'll be on in the future, but at least for that period. He didn't disappear. Yeah. Test, test. Test, test. The mic. There we go. Okay. Lapel, lapel. Good. Okay. All right. I want to start us off with a little bit of a social experiment here with Sabbath School class. So I need two volunteers for mics, and then I need some sacrifice on behalf of people sitting over there. So one of the things that we're trying to do with Sabbath School is to make it easy for everyone to hear both on the stream and in here in the meeting. And so we have ambient mics that, you know, generally pick things up for people that are on stream. But sometimes it's hard for people that are on one side of the sanctuary to hear from the other side of the sanctuary. So we're going to try out a couple roving mics today. And I think I need a volunteer to help move a mic around for this side. Thank you. Luke, it's the red one for this side, right?
Yes.
Okay. And then the blue one for the far side.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. And if those would like to come over here and sit on this half, make it a little bit easier, a little bit of sacrifice to Sabbath School. I know it's hard to move, though. Anyhow, this is one of the difficulties of having Sabbath School class in a very large sanctuary. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath. Let's start off with some prayer. Does anyone have anything that they're thankful for this week? Yes.
I do. A very good friend of mine, her 28-year-old grandson, had a brain tumor removed this week. And after brain surgery on Wednesday, he was discharged yesterday.
Great. Definitely. We have another hand. Let's raise our hand, and then it'll make it easier for the mics to get around. Anyone else have anything, any praises? You don't want to scare people with the mics, but right here.
The CHIP program has started.
Yeah, again for the... Okay, the CHIP program has started, which is good. It's one of the good ministries. Rona, if you could stay over here, that might make it a little bit easier. You can get that half. Any other praises from this week? Right here.
Prayers every single day for us, and I praise him for that.
Definitely. You have the privilege of being in connection with the great God of the universe. It's the benefit that we have as Christians. Does anyone have any prayer requests to share this morning?
So many.
So many. Anyone? Here.
I have a brother-in-law who's 83 years old, and he fell and broke his humerus. Hmm. And they said it's in two pieces, completely in two pieces, and he chipped his shoulder. He's been in quite a lot of pain. His name is Melvin Painter.
Melvin Painter is in pain. It's not very humorous, is it? Sorry. It had to be said. I apologize. I apologize. Anyone else? Any other prayer requests? All right, well, let's pray, and we'll go ahead and jump into our lesson this morning. Heavenly Father, we're glad for the opportunity to be together as a congregation, getting into your word. And we're glad for the opportunity that we have to appreciate the things that you've done for us in your lives. So what we always want to start our time together doing, just thinking about what you've done for us and who you are. We want to keep Melvin in mind, certainly breaking a bone, especially a big one is the humerus is incredibly painful. I want to pray for his recovery. And then also, I think there was a cancer diagnosis also. And then for the many unspoken prayer requests that we have. And as we transition into the lesson this morning, we ask that your spirit would be here guiding us into all truth. And we say this in Jesus' name, amen. All right. So we are in Psalms, and our topic for today is lessons of the past. So there's a number of psalms that take a look at Israel's history and get different lessons out of them. So we'll be taking a look at four or five of the different psalms and talking about them a little bit and seeing what we can learn from the lessons, because they're all a little bit different, bring out different aspects about what we can pull from the past. And again, we're doing a little experiment this morning with a handheld mic, so this will be a discussion. So if you have something to say, raise your hands and we'll get a mic over to you to talk. So we're going to start in Psalm 78. Psalm 78 this morning. This is one of the longer psalms and one of the longer histories. And so we'll focus our discussion here. So Psalm 78, it's a lengthy psalm that recounts the history of Israel, focusing on God's faithfulness and the people's disobedience, of which, if we're familiar with Israel's story, there's quite a bit of that. So I want to start us off in verses 12 and 13 of Psalm 78. Verse 12 and 13 here. Marvelous things God did in the sight of their fathers, in the land of Egypt, in the field of Zoan. He divided the sea and caused them to pass through, and he made the waters stand up like a heap. 12 and 13, and then in verse 17 coming down, because it's kind of continuing this extolling what God has done. But they sinned even more against him by rebelling against the Most High in the wilderness. And so we see this sort of this cycle that Israel, God is doing amazing things, but then there's always this period of doubt, stepping away, holding God at a distance, and being discouraged by their situation. So what can we gather from the Israelites' repeated cycles of disobedience and God's faithfulness? What are some of the things that this tells us about God? God is very patient, yeah. And he's long-suffering. And he's forgiving. His mercy. So from God, how do you think, from God's perspective, God interacts with the fact that this happens over and over again? You think that's something that God enjoys? How do we think that God handles, thinking of the story of Israel first, and then we can get into applications about us, like, how did God deal with the fact that Israel kind of had this cycle of rebelling and then over and over again? Yes.
He knows us very well. He knows that we're going to be doing this, but he has the long view in mind and knows what the end of the story is, mm-hmm. and tells us that if we're faithful, he will answer and complete the promises that he's made to us a long time ago. And the Psalms are very, give many examples of this, that Israel fails and then God takes them back. But they have to learn to repent and to follow him.
Definitely. Back over there to the left, Joe.
Psalm 78 in verse 38 says, he, being full of compassion, forgave their iniquity and did not destroy them. Yes, many a time he turned his anger away and did not stir up all of his wrath. One of the other verses there says that he did it for himself, that his name might be justified, so that the nations around Israel would learn that they served a very merciful God.
So I think this is interesting. Sometimes we can look at the Bible story and think God is maybe a little bit too harsh. But another perspective is that sometimes God is too merciful, right?
Yeah. We're never satisfied.
We're never satisfied with what things are going on. Another comment back here.
Say, in hindsight for us, it shows the covenant, the promises that God made.
He's going to be there.
So yeah.
When we do fall and realize we've fallen, he's just right there for us.
Yes, God's promises are mighty, and he's certainly standing up to that. There's a sentence from a book, A Million Miles in a Thousand Years, that it always stands out to me. That we're trees in the stories, we're trees in the story of a forest, and it's arrogant of us to think otherwise. So God is working out the story of the forest, and we're one little individual piece, and sometimes we can't think, like, why is this happening to me? When you know, and I think it's Ecclesiastes, the Bible says that time and chance happens to us all, but yet God is working out a great and grand purpose overall that we can't necessarily see the waves of it all working out. Any more thoughts on the sort of the cycle of Scott up here in the front?
On Sabbath afternoon lesson, there's a sentence, the special appeal of the historical Psalms is that they help us to see our lives as part of the history of God's people and claim that past as our own. As we have been adopted into the family of the historic people of God through Christ, the historical heritage of the ancient people of Israel is indeed the account of our spiritual ancestry. Therefore, we can and should learn from their past, which is ours as well. So they are us. You know, we look at them, well, we wouldn't have done that. No, we do that. So we're just the same. So we should learn and understand it's us.
So what should we be learning? It's kind of a general question, not necessarily right back at Scott, although if he wants to talk, he can. So, I mean, this is the story of us. I mean, you know, talking about the Pharisees, you know, of that day, and they're like, you know, they're whitewashing the tombs of the saint of the prophets, right? You know, it's like, it's always much easier to look back at a situation like, if I lived, you know, in the middle of the 1800s, I for sure would have been on the Underground Railroad, you know, I would have been helping people out. But a lot of people weren't, right? And they had their, you know, reasons and the things that kept them from doing that. It's easy for us to put ourselves and think ourselves better than those that came before us, yes? But we have to think in our own context, really, what should be, where should we be? Yes.
See, as I read the psalm, it's not easy to get out of God's hands. Hmm. It's not easy. Once you are there, he's going to fight for you. And the way he's doing it in this psalm is through discipline. Mm-hmm. And salvation. You have this combination, you know, the sin of the people, how he deals with it, discipline, but aimed at salvation so that the relationship, even though it is at risk, is preserved.
Definitely. What is the verse? No chastening at the present time is ever pleasant, but it works out the peaceful end of righteousness, or Tom's a scrambled version of things.
TSV.
So how do we learn to trust in God? I mean, we have this, you know, speaking from sort of like an internal salvational point, right? If this is the story of us and we go through this cycle of you know, trusting God and being faithful and then failing and then coming back to God, how do we have confidence of God, with God in this cycle of... Yes.
Thank you. The history.
The history.
We remember. We look back and see where God has brought us from even before we knew God. And then when we become and we know God and we see where he's brought us from, then things happen and we may be tested, but the test is not of God. We fall away. But if you look back and you remember, and you come back to God. You said, I know where he's brought me from, and I know, you know, he can do it. So the history.
Absolutely. So let's take a quick look at verse 7. This is a good transition. Thank you for setting me up. So we're looking at verse 7 here in Psalm 78. So Psalm 78, verse 7, for those that are just coming in. Let's see here. We'll start in we'll go back to verse 5 and read through verse 7. So, for he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them, the children who would be born, that they may arise and declare them to their children. Verse 7 here, that they may set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. So there's something very important about remembering what God has done, not only in the history of the scriptures, which are written for our benefit, but in our own personal lives. So what can we do to help ourselves like remember like what God has done for us? What's like a practical thing that we can do to remember what God has done for us? Yeah, right here.
When
Write it down? So like journaling, or like in your mind, how do you picture that? Journaling. Anybody else? Any other thoughts? Right back here again.
I love that she said write it down, but I'm just the type, how can I forget? I mean, I really can't. I'm being sincere. From my youth, I always remember. My mom died when I was 5. I remember God taking care of me. It was 13 of us. I look at my life now, I can't forget. Sometimes I just cry because I look back and I just wonder, what a mighty God we serve. I will never forget, never.
This is wonderful. She has the opposite superpower of me. My superpower is forgetting things. Whenever I travel, I get there and I'm like, man, I forgot my dress shoes. Or my dress socks or something. We have a comment over here. But I do think it's important writing down. So for me, writing things down has utility. And I'm glad that people are better at remembering things. So in my worship time, I don't like saying journal because guys don't journal, right? I just write things down. So I have a book of praises where I just try to write like 2 or 3 things that I'm thankful for every day down. So then I can look, and I try to be as detailed as possible because I know I'm going to forget, so I can go back and revisit. But over here?
There is a statement, we learn by doing. You know, we have to put to practice, not just write down, but we have to do and put to practice, you know, that what we write down so that we can, that it becomes character and it becomes habit. You know, so that it would be part of us. It's automatic. You know, it's not just something that that we'll just have to, because we can forget what we write down, and we'll lose that piece of paper, or if it's on a tablet, it can be erased, you know, or whatever. So, but if it's etched in our minds, you know. It's part of us. It's character. It's automatic.
Definitely. When we do something, we put it into practice, it becomes easier for us. So first here, and then we'll go here.
When you actually say the whatever it is, it puts it in your mind.
Yes.
It keeps
when
it
you
in there,
speak
fresh.
It and whatever. I think it's interesting that this passage combines it with sharing it with other people. I think it's speaking generational, but I think this is, so one of the things that we can do is have opportunities here in a congregational sense, in a church sense, where we share things that God has done for us, right? So I think this is one of the benefits that we have of starting off like a Sabbath school with sharing things that we're thankful for, that God has done for us, because then it speaks it out into the open. And then this saying, it deepens our own memory, and then it also puts a memory out communally of how God is working in different ways. And then we're like, you know, God is working. If we didn't necessarily sense something like God touching us this week, you know, God is still active. He's still out there working in the forest. Yes.
It was essentially sharing. Yesterday, my daughter had an incident. She had a stomach bug. And the same thing, she was feeling so bad and cramping. And she's like, Mom, I prayed. And then later, very shortly after, she fell asleep. And I'm like, you know what? God answered your prayer. And so I go share that with your friends. And that's how you can see God. I think that's one of the most powerful things, where just on the little things, God cares. So sharing, I think it's a huge thing. So
absolutely. And then we have another comment here, and then we'll head to our next psalm. To your left, Rona, right there. Yeah.
In the case of the Psalms, I don't know how many of the Jews actually could read and write at that time. Maybe many, but in general, over the ages, most people couldn't read or write. The Psalms are songs that they sang to remind themselves, and we're lucky to still have them because we can go back now. But basically, they sang their history and reminded themselves of where they succeeded and where they failed. And that's another interesting thing about the Bible, is that most propaganda books that people or governments put out don't tell about their failures. They only talk about their victories. But this shows the whole gamut of what happened with Israel, and it's an encouragement to us mm-hmm. because we know that we fail, and we can see that they were too. But God is faithful, and He will answer our prayers.
Definitely. And I think it was one of the Wesley brothers. Don't peg me on which one, but I'm sure other people did this too. But took the Psalms and put them into English meter so that they could be sung easier within the church context. And so I have it in my Bible software or something. But I think it's good. You know, when we see when we sing things, it gets into our memory easier. Our next psalm that we're going to is 105. 105. And we have a couple of back-to-backs. So we have 105 and then 106, two historical psalms this morning. And we'll start us off with the first five verses of Psalm 105. O give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing psalms to him, talk of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face forevermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. And we'll stop there. So we've talked a little bit about, you know, being thankful and sharing those things. So the psalmist here, we have a nameless psalm here, encourages people to remember God's miraculous deeds and to sing praises to him. So how do we, as we've talked about being thankful, how do we cultivate a spirit of thankfulness to make it something that we do more naturally? So we want to expound on that for. How do we make it something that becomes more natural of who we are, being thankful?
Practice
it? How so? How do you picture that in your mind?
Making the comment what you're thankful for.
Making comment.
Sometimes you just have to say, I'm thankful for sunshine. I'm thankful for food we eat. I'm thankful for my family. And keep saying it. Keep practicing.
Yeah, definitely.
I love what she said, the small things. You know, God doesn't forget the small things. You know, the sun shines. Why would we? But through prayer and thanksgiving, and what's in you is going to come out of you. And if you're thankful, you're going to pass that on to others, just like the food train, you know, that we're doing now in the church. If that's not in you through prayer and thanksgiving and gratitude of what God has done for you, then nothing's going to come out of you. Whatever's in you is going to come out, good, bad, or indifferent.
So. Definitely. Another cup. Amen. And then right here.
Yes, right here in church, when people are grateful for birthdays, etc., they bring flowers to the church.
It's true. You do this every week.
I just looked in front there and I said, maybe someone has a special occasion, a birthday or an anniversary. So there are practical things that one can do to show how grateful one is to God for his goodness. You can bless others. You can take somebody out, buy a meal, do something that you show that you are grateful to God for what he has blessed you with.
Absolutely. And over here?
Because I was going to say witnessing and sharing him with others.
Yep, witnessing and sharing. And then Scott right here. And I think everything good that we have comes from God. So if it's a cloudy day and there's no sunshine in our heart on any particular day, which, you know, emotions are cyclical. They're kind of up and down. So not every day is a good day for us, even if everything is good in our lives. Emotions are kind of up and down. But, you know, if we're just generally in a place where we don't feel like there's a lot of sunshine in our soul, that we have things to be thankful for, we can ask God, I'm like, Lord, help me to be able to express thanks more. Help me to be able to express praise more. And this is something that God will be able to work in us to do. Scott?
It's easy. It's more normal for someone like me to atrophy into what's not right about things. I'm just critical by nature, so that's where I go. If somebody talks to me, I'm looking for flaws in what they're saying. I'm not looking for the good. So for someone like me, I have to be very deliberate about I am going to deliberately look for things to be thankful for. And when I start to be deliberate about it, and I make it a practice or a habit of looking for things to be thankful, it becomes a bit more normal. Mm-hmm. But I have to be deliberate or it doesn't happen. So for me, I have to really push it.
Definitely. And I think that's an important mindset, especially for those that tend to have the gift of discernment, you know, where you're able to listen to what people say and have an idea of, well, that'll work and that's not going to work, and it just comes very naturally. I'm kind of like that too. We have to keep in mind like a ratio of like positive expressions to negative expressions. You got to balance out the expressions. Even though it's hard, you're like, but I know it's a bad idea anyway. Right here. And then move on with another question. Yep.
One of the ways to help for me to be thankful is, mm-hmm. particularly those of us who may be involved in medical work, we tend to be surrounded by people who are not having a good day. And you know, to remember, God, by the grace of God, I'm reasonably well. I have so much to be grateful for, and to concentrate, what can I do to help the other people have a better day? Mm-hmm. It takes our mind off ourselves. The devil wants us to look at ourselves as number one. Jesus says, you know, I'm not number one. I'm here to serve others.
Definitely. And I want to move on down to another couple of verses. Was there a hand back here? Dr. Rodriguez had something over here. And then move on to our next question.
It is not natural to be grateful. Mm. We're selfish by nature, so we consider it a kind of a weakness to be grateful. I would suggest that we have to begin with making a decision. From now on, I'm going to be grateful. This is the rest of my life. And if you read the Psalms, you will discover very, very quickly that the psalmist is constantly looking for reasons to be grateful. It's amazing, the little things that he mentions. So you have a person that is checking to say thank you, you know, to open the heart. And there is another dimension to it. Allow me just one more second. Mm-hmm. Memory, remembrance. Mm-hmm. In order to be grateful, sometimes we have to remember. But in the Bible, and even in Western culture, remembrance activates emotions. They do. So if I remember how the Lord protected me or granted me a petition, the joy of that moment is lived again. It's a wonderful Christian experience.
Definitely. And emotions are one of the things that make memories stick. If you have also images and singing, and emotions are what make memories stick. And then I think also it's a good point to point out that being thankful, being grateful, is a weakness of humanity across the board. This is why Jesus highlighted a couple of his experiences were highlighted in the Gospels. You know, of the lepers, right? They, like, two of them came back out of 10, and Jesus is like, wow, this is exceptional. It's not that exceptional, but because it's so difficult for us as human beings to express that thanks, that's why it was highlighted. So we have to make that choice and make it a part of who we are. So we're in Psalms 105, and I want to go down to verse 7 and 8 right now. 7 and 8 of 105. And this thought here was mentioned earlier, but we'll get into it a little bit more. So he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the word which he commanded for 1,000 generations. So I want to focus here on this idea of covenant, which was mentioned earlier. So God recounts the story of his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, as well as the Israelites' journey through slavery. So when we think of the covenant that God has made and his mercy of sort of renewing it again and again, What does this tell us about God's character? How does this help us to understand who he is?
He never changes, and he'll be constant. He's always there.
Definitely. God interacts with us, but yet his character and who he is, his character qualities don't change. And so he's upholding his side of the interaction despite our unfaithfulness, which is certainly comforting. Any other thoughts here as God's commitment to the covenant expresses his character?
He's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Absolutely. Denitsa.
God thinks long term. We think momentarily, so I'm unhappy because something happens today. God says, I'm with you. I have a future for you. And to me, the covenant represents something that is to come. And I can walk with the certainty that something better is coming up.
Definitely. Definitely gives us something to trust in. So let's switch over to Psalms 106 now. And so Psalms 106, as we're in the historical Psalms this morning, looking at God's history of his interaction with his people from the perspective of the different psalmists. We have another nameless psalm here in, well, let's see, in 106. And this one is acknowledging both God's faithfulness and the people's repeated disobedience. So we're coming back to that theme here. So actually, let me think about this here. Actually, let's go to Psalm 80. Let's go to Psalm 80, because I think we've covered the discussion point for Psalms 106. So we're going to Psalm 80. So Psalm 80, and we'll look at verse 19 here. So Psalm 80 is a prayer for God's restoration and intervention on behalf of his people. And there's one verse that's repeated a number of times down through this chapter, which reminds us from something earlier in Leviticus, but we will start here in verse 19. Restore us, O Lord God of hosts. Cause your face to shine, and we shall be saved. You know, this reminds us of, you know, this is how Michael always ends his sermons, right? Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord be gracious, make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. That's not all the words, but most of it I can remember on the face of it. So how can we cultivate a spirit of humility and repentance here? So this is, restore us, O Lord God of hosts. So as we've talked about, you know, the cycle of Israel's and our, you know, falling away and then coming back to God. And we've talked about praise and building that into our habits as a people. How do we cultivate a spirit of repentance? Yeah. Looks like he's got something to say over there.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. I need some glasses here so I can read my phone. So he's a good friend. Let's see.
Oh, right. Let's see if the reading glasses
microphone
work.
And glasses.
You know, we're cultivating a spirit of sharing too this morning also.
Now I feel like I'm really on the spot.
Oh man.
So this morning in my worship, I was looking at a book from A.W. Tozer.
The mic to the mouth.
What's that? Oh, I'm sorry. Thanks, Tom. This morning, during my worship, I was looking at a book from A.W. Tozer, and there's a sentence he makes here. So when you're talking about how to frame your question.
Cultivate again, a spirit of repentance.
Well, here you go. Much our difficulty as seeking Christians stems from our unwillingness to take God as he is and adjust our lives accordingly. We insist upon trying to modify him and to bring him nearest to our image. The flesh whimpers against the right of God's sentence and begs, and it goes on and on and on. Mm-hmm. So the point is
where's our focus?
Mm-hmm.
What are we trying to do? Are we trying to get closer to God? What can we do in our lives to simply seek Him, figuring Him out, trying to learn more about Him versus trying to get what we always want to do? So I think that's a starting point.
Coming to a relational experience with God, a friendship, and a saving faith, rather than treating God like a Santa Claus. There's many books on prayer that are out there and that exist. And now that I'm in front of everyone, I can't remember the name, but he died a year or so ago from cancer, Tim Keller. And in his book on prayer, it's always interesting. Sometimes there's topics that are out there that you're like, I don't think I can really learn anything about prayer. I feel like I understand prayer pretty well. I did learn some interesting things. One of them was the idea that, you know, Christian prayer is unique in that it builds the idea of repentance and confession into the very heart of Christian prayer. Because not all prayer does that in the communication with whatever the divine is. But when we come to God, we acknowledge our shortcoming and depend on His wholeness and His completeness.
I think for me, reflecting on Friday's lesson, where Ellen White encourages us not just on a yearly basis to evaluate Psalms 105, 106, but on a weekly basis. Mm-hmm. That as we evaluate those Psalms and recognize that it's really about us, we're the ones that are like Israel, we're the ones that are rebelling, that then helps to create that spirit of repentance and humility, saying, Lord, don't let me be like these people.
And I think and it can speak to, as we're talking about mindsets and mindset of repentance. I think some people project that Christians think that they're better than other people, right? I mean, you know, God is calling us to a standard of behavior, so there is that. But I think the real perspective is it's an inversion of that perspective in that sliding scale. So if you perhaps you've had an interaction like this where you're talking with someone, and they're like, "Well, I'm a good person." You know, I'm a good person. But I think the more that we come into interaction with God, the more that we appreciate Jesus' purity and just absolute perfection and spotless of character, that we come to realize, like, man, I fall very, very short of who God is and what He's calling me to be. And so the closer that we come to God, the more we realize our shortcoming, and the more it puts us into a right relation with God where we depend fully on what He has done for us. And then we realize our need of this attitude of repentance and this mindset. But it's good. The more we come into that position, the more we realize what God is and has done for us. And the more we can also develop an idea of thankfulness also. Was there another hand over back here? Yeah.
Repentance really is a gift from God, and that's where it has to start.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Romans 12, or maybe that's faith as a gift from God, but all these things that we have, you know, repentance and faith are not something that we do to bring ourselves closer to God. All these things are a gift from God Himself. Yes.
I agree with what was said in the back about humility and prayer. And it said, help us not to be like the Israelites. To me, we need the mirror effect. If we look in the mirror and we're praying and we're humbling ourselves, really, when I look in the mirror, I see that I'm just as bad. You may not have done what they did, but there are things in your lives. If it weren't, and we were perfect and ready, we would have already, you know, pretty much transcended. And so there's a lot that we need to improve on. I know in my life, mm-hmm. you know, I can look, and I don't have to look too deep. Just humility and prayer, and God will show up and show you where you need to, you know, improve or
yeah,
what you
definitely.
Need to be doing.
So there's a comment in the back there. But so Matthew 7, I think, speaks to this, right, where it cautions us against judging other people. Certainly, the Bible says in certain contexts, judging is okay, but it warns us against setting ourselves up as the standard. Because the longer I go through life, the more I realize the things that upset me and other people are really just the things that I don't like about myself. Does anyone resonate with that? And so, you know, I'm like, man, I can't believe that that person did X, Y, Z. And then I just think, I'm like, did I or have I done something like that? And the answer is, I probably don't have to think very hard to think that I probably did the same thing. So am I willing to be level the playing field and condemn myself with them? Or am I really just wanting to cast aspersions in just one direction at that point in time? Yes.
Yes, and knowing that history repeats itself, and that there was a generation that had forgotten what God had done for them and had given over to idolatry and not wanting to do the same thing and not wanting to forget who I am and whose I am and not wanting to make that same mistake.
Definitely. I just want to bring these things into remembrance so we can remember them. Psalm 135, our last psalm and our last question in our 5 minutes. So Psalm 135, as we're looking at historical psalms and looking for the lessons that we can learn from them. So Psalm 135, it's a hymn of praise. It's exalting God's greatness and his sovereignty. There's a lot of praising the Lord that's happening here in this psalm. And I want to look at verses 13 and 14. So 13 and 14 in Psalms 135. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your fame, O Lord, throughout all generations. For the Lord will judge his people, and he will have compassion on his servants. One of the things I like about these verses is it points out the idea that the judgment's a good thing, right? We have a God who is our judge and our advocate. He's on our side, and he's bringing us to a place. And he also covers us with his righteousness. So hopefully it brings us to a point where we can stand with assurance, you know, as we're thinking and facing the judgment. But I want to think about this, because as we've looked through the historical psalms, what does it mean that God will judge his people and have compassion on them? Because we've seen a number of examples where God is dealing out punishments here in these stories. So how do we level set this, where God is having compassion on us, but God is also setting out punishments? Scott?
Yeah, the word judge doesn't always mean to find guilty.
Tell me more.
The word judge can also mean to vindicate.
Vindicate.
So when it comes to the judgment, we always think of it in the negative sense. But as you read through the book of Daniel, when God judged his people, he vindicated his people. Daniel means the Lord is judge, but it can also mean the Lord vindicates. So it's not always bad, is the point. When you go to court with somebody, there is an innocent party and a guilty party, because they're always ruling in favor or against the plaintiff or what the defendant, whatever it might be. So I think sometimes we always view it negatively, that God will judge his people. We always say, cower, right? But no, he's, because of the blood of Jesus, we're found innocent. And in that sense, I believe here in the context of this psalm, the judge is vindicated. The judge is found innocent, not guilty.
Definitely. This reminds me of what I think Amadeus said last week. Correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the things that he was pointing out is that, you know, God does get upset sometimes at the things that we do, but his reaction to what we do is not ours, where we're out to possibly get even sometimes. God is always restorative in how he deals with us, right? So even with Israel, as God is dealing out punishments, allowing nations to come in and take Israel and carry some of them captive, even in that, God is restorative, because he's trying to bring his people back to them. And in some of these psalms, and I don't remember which one, but just in reading through the different ones, it points out that even as some people were carried away, God turned the hearts of their captors toward them so that they were nice to them in their dispersion. So any other thoughts, like in the mindset of, you know, how we balance this out of, you know, God judges us, but he also has mercy. Any other final thoughts here? Right. Well, what we have here in the Psalms, you know, we have many Psalms that are talking about God's love and care, and then reaching out to God in different types of emotional contexts. We also have these historical psalms that talk about how God has worked with his people over the course of time. Some of them just highlight, you know, God's faithfulness, his upkeeping of his covenant through time. Some of them talk about our failings as human beings, you know, the historical people, and then also ours as we see ourselves in them. And sort of ending on this note of judgment, the reason we have these psalms is for a purpose. God is trying to bring us closer to them. He's like, you know, we have the opportunity, whether we learn the lessons ourselves the hard way or we learn them from other people, hopefully a little bit of an easier way. So these psalms are given to us so that we can look at them, learn the lessons of other people's experience, apply them to our own lives, and in the end, draw closer to Christ. So let's pray, and we will head into the main service. So Heavenly Father, we're glad for the opportunity to come together as a class this morning and to study your word. And we ask your blessing as we head into the second service here today. We ask that the congregational worship would bring our hearts closer together, and then the word would speak.